Hello, everybody. I'm Dana Moore, and I'm here for my Fosse Q&A. The Legacy, the Verdon Fosse Legacy, we asked you to send in your questions, and we would answer them, and that's what this Fosse Q&A is. And these are my questions sent in for me, and I've got my index cards. I'm ready to go, so let's begin. My first one is from Chloe Akasha. Hope I got that right, Chloe. Chloe actually has a threefold question here. The first one is, what did it feel like to dance in Fosse shows on stage every night? What comes to mind, actually, is a conversation I was having with Mr. Fosse, and he was telling me about this circus performer. He was having a conversation with the circus performer was a seasoned gentleman, had been doing it for many, many years. He was an aerialist and a high wire performer. And this gentleman said to Mr. Fosse, life is only when I'm up on that wire. All the rest is waiting. And actually, that's referenced in the movie All That Jazz, which I didn't even realize at the time until I saw the movie again and I went, oh. But that is Mr. Fosse. And that is what it is, being on that stage. That's life and all the rest is waiting. Changing your costume and coming back on that stage and doing that work, it's magic. And it's really like you're up on the high wire and all the rest is waiting. And it really is being in the show, being in the theater with your fellow, everybody feeling like they're up on the high wire. And I just remember in the dressing room, we would say to one another, just kind of spontaneously getting ready, putting our makeup on, and we would say, we get to do this. We get to go out there and do this. And that's what it's like to be on stage performing a Fosse show, really. And number two from Chloe, her next question, your next question, Chloe, is who is your favorite actor and singer? Well, there are so many that come to mind. And no matter what, I keep coming back to Gwen Verdon. And especially as I have in later years, I've been having to research Gwen and watch so much of her work specifically to work on different things and reconstruct. And it validated all that I thought before when I was just seeing her on a television screen or up on a stage, even talking to her. You don't even think about her vocal, even though she's singing and lovely singer on stage, just on stage playing a role. It's just part of the role and it's the scenes, the dancing, she just embodies it all in a way that I don't know anybody else who does that. I mean, she kind of is someone that kind of, I think, walked about an inch off the ground because she was kind of so connected to the angels or something. So grounded and so lifted at the same time, and her dancing, you didn't, She just was the character. And no matter what she was doing, nothing was separate. It wasn't in pieces. And anyway, that's why she's my favorite actor and singer and dancer. I lied. Chloe only had two questions for me. All right, Chloe, thank you. Those were great questions. Let's move on to number two, and that is Riley Jones. Riley asks, what was your favorite number you were in? And I have to say, Riley, that's a hard one, because pretty much every number I was in, whether I was rehearsing it, learning it, performing it, that was my favorite number to do, because everything, every part of the work of working with Mr. Fosse and doing that work, yeah, just, it's hard to pick, but I'm going to pick one. And that is The Rich Man's Fugue from Sweet Charity. And it has a very special connection with me. That connection is that I was the ponytail girl in The Rich Man's Fugue, in the revival that Bob and Glenn were still around in 1986. And Debbie Allen was our Sweet Charity. Yeah, that was definitely at the top. Of course, other numbers came to mind. Crunchy Granola Sweet. Just amazing to be a part of that. And to be a part of that whole ensemble of work. Same as The Rich Man's Fugue and Dancin' Man. Every lyric, every rhythm, every step, every style, it's where we all live. We dancers or artists or, yeah, Dancin' Man, very, very special. Okay, I said I was only gonna give you one and I gave you three, but I hope that's okay, Riley. And that was number two. Number three is David Wallach. David asks, why do you think Fosse's work has such staying power? Fosse's work has such staying power. I've jotted down some notes here, and one of my notes is the exquisite language of his style. His brilliant musicality. And it was always rooted, what do I have here? Always rooted in the human condition. And all of those things are universal and are timeless. So really honestly, I think that's the answer to that question. Alrighty, thank you, David. Great question. These questions are great. I'm telling you, it's really made me have to think. I mean, really think about what I really feel about these things and what I really experienced instead of what I think maybe the answer should be. So thank you for that. Still learning in my old age. All right, number four, Cameron Reed. If one Fosse show could be revived today, which would you want it to be and why? It's a hard question for me. And I think the thing that gives me pause about that question is I would love to see any Fosse show revived, but it would have to be done under the auspices of the estate and of Nicole and of the reconstructors that are you know, that lived it in ways that helps us to teach it, or it actually completely informs how we teach it, because we're teaching it the way it was taught to us. And yeah, that's why it would need to be done. Any revival of Mr. Fosse's work would need to be very carefully, preciously taken care of. But of course, again, I don't have just one answer. The top of my list would be Sweet Charity. And that is, especially now in this time that we're going through, especially poignant, because Charity's name, actually, her middle name is Hope, Charity Hope Valentine. And that show, Sweet Charity, is so full of hope under lots of conflict and lots of situations that are hard, and you know, the ladies in the Fandango ballroom just really working so hard and feeling, you know, so kind of stuck. But there always was hope. And even the character of Oscar, very conflicted, but always had that hope. Charity, my goodness, she's the, you know, the essence of, you know, I'm gonna dust myself off and I'm gonna go on. Nothing's gonna stop me. So right now, that's a perfect show to revive. Anyway, it's a great show. Okay, I'm gonna stop there. I could give you other ones, but that'll do it. All right, number five, Lindsay G. Lindsay asks, what has been the hardest number to reconstruct? They're all hard. I can't make one at the top of that list. Every one of them are all in the same plane of, they're just, it's, yeah, technically all show, every show is, or every number is very complicated and very difficult, and also, you know, quite rewarding to reconstruct if we get to do it the way we want to do it. And that is the way we rehearsed it, or rehearsed with Mr. Fosse. And that is, you know, with not just the technique and the style, and believe me, those are like really, you know, there are no shortcuts, as I maybe said earlier. It's the style, the technique, and also informing on top of that, or within that, the authentic intent. And the rehearsal time is never what it needs to be. Repetition was the foundation of the rehearsal process. So that really makes it difficult to reconstruct this material, as I would imagine, you know, most greats. And Mr. Fosse was the great that I, well, you know, I mean, I love him. Okay, same. Okay, and now it is Lindsay again. And her second question is, what has been the most fun to reconstruct? What number has been the most fun to reconstruct? And the first, my little note there is, the first thing that came to mind is reconstructing the movie version of Big Spender for the FX Verdon Fosse series. It's Fosse Verdon, isn't it? It's the Verdon Fosse Legacy, and FX was Fosse Verdon. Anyway, I had so much, even though it was not enough time ever, not enough rehearsal time, but it was such a comprehensive rehearsal. I mean, we had the bar and I had these women who were incredibly willing actresses and incredibly beautiful dancers who were willing to take this on and take on these different characters that were already laid out in the movie. And just, I mean, it was just incredible to watch these ladies work and to work with them. And, you know, it was all costumes and lighting and, you know, done as it was supposed to have been done and when they were shooting the movie. So I would say that is definitely my favorite number to have reconstructed so far. All right. Oh, there's another question from Lindsay. All right. Lindsay wants to know, what is the most valuable performance skill you learned from working with Bob and Gwen? Valuable is a good word there, because, well, I'm going to say this and then you'll understand why I said that. I learned to trust the work, to trust the process, like all the way to like giving up all my judgments to empty and trust right then and there everything that I was experiencing. Trust the work, trust the process, and to believe in myself and my limitless abilities. Which even as I say it, I'm like, get stuck in my throat, because I've gotten better as I've gotten older, for sure. And certainly as I've become a teacher, I realize how important this is to share this, that we have to value our gifts and take risks with those gifts, not be safe. And that was the kind of experience I got that really was really deep into my soul. I got that message, and I'm so grateful that I even recognize it so that I can share it as a teacher. Alrighty. That's it. That's it, Lindsay. All right, you got a lot there, did you? Number 6 is Kimberly Reigert. And Kimberly asked this question: how do you, as an educator, talk this generation of dancers off from focusing on tricks and getting them back to the art of proper technique and performance? All right, I jotted down some notes for myself because this is such a great question. Excellent question, Kimberly. And it's one I take very seriously as a teacher. I'm humbled and grateful to take on this quite enormous challenge in this time with dancers, actors, singers, all of us who move on the stage. I have two words that I've written here: guide and value. So let's see what I've got here. More notes that I took the second time I went through this. It is my it's the only way I can work in that studio, in a class, and that is to create a safe environment, to not have to be perfect, to take a risk, to not be right, to learn about and to inform your own personal journey. And that's why that safe environment is so important. Because what I see come out when people are taking a risk and not caring what they look like in the mirror or trying to be perfect for me, doing the steps perfectly, getting the steps, of course, I want them, getting the style, of course, but it's nothing if it doesn't have you taking that risk, not being afraid to be awkward, you know, and all of that, giving yourself permission. To believe in yourself, really. And I do say this, you wouldn't be in this classroom if you didn't know from probably a very early age that you have this passion, you have this joy. That's what comes when you get yourself into a class and start dancing and start learning and working so hard. You wouldn't even be in that classroom in New York City with me if you didn't know that. But we kind of get here and we get all, you know, nervous about being judged. And of course, auditions really contribute to that. All that rejection and all that looking around at everybody else that's got their leg higher and they're singing a high C. And that is what I really need to keep safe, keep precious, that you can be, that one can be why you're here, you know. And it takes time, you know. It takes taking those risks. It takes falling, tripping, doing all the wrong things, not being perfect. I don't want to see perfect. I want to see lived. And there's nothing like that. And that is definitely, definitely, definitely where, from my experience, where Mr. Fosse came from and Miss Verdon came from. And I'm so grateful to have had that experience and humbled and so grateful to share. All right, that's it. That's a lot of talking, but that was it. Thank you so much for your questions and please stay healthy and stay hopeful. And I'll see you next time.